Ladies and gentlemen, Stan Verrett is now officially dropping jewels with Julien Virgin.
Julien Virgin.
And Mr. Verrett, how you living?
I'm good, man. It's great being in South Florida, being at NABJ. I mean, this is always a source of energy and inspiration for me, so it's great to be here.
When you were 25, as I am right now, were you going to NABJ?
It was a couple of years after that, probably when I was 26 or 27, I first started coming. And it was always, for me, a thing where not only I came to look for jobs and network and everything, but I also met my peers, you know, and we exchanged information about how to survive in the business, how to thrive in the business. I mean, who was going where and doing what and job openings here and that sort of thing. And so, you know, a lot of us, when we're in small markets, we're all going through the same thing, you know, living places where we didn't want to live, you know, doing jobs that were, you know, arduous. You know, working nights and working weekends. And so, you know, it's a chance to commiserate, reconnect, recharge, and go back inspired. And so I always used NABJ every year as my measuring stick as to how I had done in the past year, how I had progressed, and the goals that I wanted to set for the next year. So this has always been important to me. I mean, I try not to ever miss NABJ. But as a matter of fact, I got it written into my contract at ESPN that I always get to come to this.
And I respect that. As a young journalist, it's always very important for me to see people that I see all the time on television. Much respect to what you do and how you do it. But here, giving back, you know.
Absolutely.
I'm not so big on, you know, you have to give back. But it's important to me that I see that you took the time to do that. It's like, okay, much respect. It's real.
Thank you, man. A part of the mission of NABJ is to make sure that we're represented in newsrooms across the country, across the world. And so those of us in my generation, we're not going to work forever, you know, and we need that next generation to come through and occupy those seats when we leave them. And we need to make sure that they're trained and ready to go when that time comes. And so people did that for me. And so now I'm just paying it forward. I mean, that's the legacy of NABJ. That's what we do.
Most definitely. Now, you talked about how when you come to NABJ, you were able to meet your peers as y'all were coming up and going through the process, ultimately.
Yep.
Could you speak a little bit more about your process and how you got to where you are today at ESPN?
So I went to Howard University, studied journalism there. You know, people tell you all the time, if you want to be a broadcaster, get in however you can. So my entryway in was radio, but it was music radio. And so I was a DJ all through college on a radio station in Washington. And then when I got out, the consultant at the station where I worked all through college had a station in Charleston, South Carolina that he also worked with. They had a full-time opening, so I took it and ran with it. Moved to Charleston, worked there for 3 years. Left there, went to Norfolk, Virginia for another radio job. And then about that time, I started saying, okay, I want to make my way into television now. That was always my goal, to do sports TV. I'm like, okay, I'm done with this radio thing, so let me start working my way into TV. So got an opportunity in Norfolk to do TV. Wound up working for two stations there over a four-year period. Then I went home to New Orleans to work for the NBC affiliate in New Orleans, which was my hometown. I got to cover the Saints and LSU and Tulane, Sugar Bowl, Bayou Classic. And so that was fun for 2 years. And then, you know, sent my resume tape out and built on a relationship that I had initially started at NABJ with the recruiters from ESPN, who were always here every year. And I always made it a point to go by that ESPN booth, have them look at my work, tell me how I could improve and what it would take for me to get to where I wanted to go. And I think that's one of the things about NABJ, if I could just go off on another little tangent here, you can create relationships over time. I didn't get the job at ESPN the first time I went to the ESPN booth. It was the third time. And so the recruiter from ESPN was able to see my work grow and blossom and know that I used some of the tips that he gave me about how to improve my work. And so I think that carried some weight with, you know, from year to year coming back and having him see the growth. I mean, at that point, he sort of invested in the growth. And so, you know, that recruiter selected me to get a job at ESPN. And, you know, I'm not saying that it definitely would have happened without NABJ, but I know it happened because of NABJ, you know, because that's where that relationship was fostered. So that's how I got to where I am. I got to ESPN in 2000. 2009, we opened up a studio in Los Angeles, and so I moved there with Neil Everett, and we do SportsCenter from LA every night, and I'm living the dream.
I remember when that transition actually took place, man. There was a sense of pride from a young buck. I was in ninth grade when you made that transition to ESPN LA.
Man, you're making me feel old.
I mean,
now you're a grown man.
Just a little bit, but as I'm listening to you tell your story about your process, my start is in radio.
Yep.
Right? I DJ. I spin records. I always like to say I spin records because I understand like that's not the end goal.
Right.
That's what I'm doing currently right now.
Yep.
In order to make it work. I work at a radio station. I actually just left the radio station to make sure that I'm continuing to push the envelope and go further. Now, I'm in a transition phase, and I'm sure you've been in many transition phases. Talk about that phase and the emotions that go into when you're in between opportunities and how you overcame those emotions to get to your next journey.
That's a great question, and you know, we've all been through it. I mean, you're not really in the business until you get fired, you know? So I worked for the radio station in Charleston where I worked. Once that station got a 50,000 watt transmitter, the general manager there decided that he didn't need to spend as much on on-air people because he had this big signal boost now. And so he came in and fired the whole staff, hired all new people for half of what we were making, you know? And we were the staff that had gotten him through the ratings battles in Charleston when he only had a 6,000 watt transmitter, and we needed every single pair of ears that were available to us to listen to our station. So once he got the 50,000 watts, he figured, okay, well, I don't, you know, and I just remember walking in and our news person who was on with me in the morning, she's like, we've all been fired. And I'm like, I kind of knew when they called me on a Sunday to come in, I'm like, oh, this is unusual, you know? So you know, I had to do a lot of introspection during that time. And I tried to use the time wisely to not only look for another job, but to just set the format for how I wanted to be as a broadcaster, as a professional, as a person. And that time that I had to stop and consider that, and just kind of take a break and just say, okay, where do you want this to go? And how do you want to approach this, you know? And during that time, this was in the mid-90s, you know, Michael Jordan was the man on top of the NBA. And I remember reading a story about Michael Jordan that said he not only had incredible natural ability, but he was also the hardest worker of anybody in the NBA. So I said, wow, you know, if I can combine my natural ability with a real serious work ethic, you know, there's no telling where I could go. So I really devoted myself during that time to say, okay, anything that I do from this point forward, you know, I have to give it my absolute best because I'm learning the hard way right now that this can be a cruel business, it can be an unforgiving business. And so, you know, I got fired through no fault of my own during that situation, but it still felt like somehow I bore some responsibility for it. And so I said, okay, this is never gonna happen again. I'm gonna make myself so valuable to whoever I wind up working for. I'm gonna insulate myself from ever having to feel this again. And so that's kind of been how I've tried to approach it.
So before we get off this bus, I want your final thoughts, Mr. Verrett. What do you want other young journalists out there like myself to know?
I was at NABJ in Orlando several years ago, but there's a woman named Paula Madison who spoke at NABJ. Paula is one of the titans of our industry. Well, she was delivering a keynote address, and it was at a time I was at ESPN, but I was trying to find my way there, and I was just wondering where I fit in and, you know, trying to move up and the whole thing, and I was just kind of like, well, you know, there was some confusion, you know, and I was trying to sort things out, you know, and Paula, in her keynote address at that NABJ, said, you are equipped to make it in this business, to be successful in this business, just the way you are. You don't have to fundamentally change who you are in order to make it. And it was a message that I really, really needed to hear at that time specifically. And I felt like she was talking somehow to me. And we've become friends now over the years. And every time I see her, I always bring that back up. So I've tried to continue to share that message that you are equipped with everything that you need. If you work hard, if you really commit yourself to being successful, you don't have to change who you are in order to be successful. You can do it being your authentic self. And I think that's important for young journalists to know because, like I said, this can be a cruel, unforgiving business. And, you know, sometimes you can feel like you're out here alone trying to make it, but you can do it. Keep believing in yourself, keep working hard, and you can do it, whatever you want to do.
I received that message. Stan Verrett, I appreciate you dropping jewels with Julian Virgin, man.
Julian,
much
thank
respect.
You for having me, man.
Much respect. Thank
all
you.
Right.